A good worship today. Thank you guys so much. If you have your Bibles, would you please open them up to Ephesians chapter 5 as we continue our series that we started a month or so ago entitled Biblical Romance. We're looking, if you're new with us, we're looking at biblical principles for the most important relationship that most of us will ever have, kind of from beginning to end. Song of Solomon is this like snapshot of what this relationship should look like ideally. Ideally meaning it's like the perfection of the relationship, knowing that all of us are going to fall short here and there as we go along. It's a snapshot of the relationship from the kind of the beginning of what we should be attracted to, knowing that, looking for that, finding that character in someone before you even begin to invest and then date and court and then move into principles of marriage. Now today, we're going to spend about 5 seconds in the book of Song of Solomon. That's why I didn't ask you to turn there. Chapter 3, 6 through 11, really is a picture of their wedding day. They finally get married. There's this huge procession, meaning it's a celebration for all those who have been involved in their life, those who have been involved in the relationship, and they are blessing it. They're saying, this is a good thing. That's why we date in community. We allow other people to be a part of our relationship. Solomon says in the section, he commits to saying, basically, I'm not going to be a relationship oaf. I'm all in, I will invest, I will protect, I'll provide. And so I'm kind of using that passage as an excuse or an opportunity to dive into the New Testament and look at some principles that Paul gives us for marriage, that any time that you're looking at Scripture, it doesn't matter what biblical book you are in, if you're talking about marriage, these principles have to be discussed. They cannot be left out. Now, as a pastor for some 20-odd years, I've had the incredible opportunity to participate in a lot of weddings. Usually, they're an incredible blast, and I do say usually. I've been a part of a few family disasters along the way, but usually, they're just incredible. They're great because there's so much life, excitement, hope, love. I get to kind of be behind the scenes. Oftentimes, everyone gets sat in the church or the chapel, whatever it is, and I'm out with the guys hanging out, and then you kind of hear the music, and that's when the jokes start flying of, hey man, that's your last chance, make a break for it. This is your last moment that you will be single, and he always just kind of awkwardly laughs, ha ha, because he knows there's actually truth in what they're saying. Then we kind of get the cue, it's time to go in, and you know, the guys usually do like a headbutt chest pump as they go in for like, it's like a football game, they're excited. The way I done the weddings, for the most part, I usually take the guys, we kind of go down the side, and he's standing there waiting as the bridesmaids start entering into the church, and I can sense his anticipation, his excitement, his nerves. There's times where I can really feel it, so I just kind of put a hand on his shoulder. Whoa, boy, you're going to make it. It's going to be okay. And then there's that moment that we all have seen, and that the doors fly open, and there's the bride. And I don't care who she is. The bride is always just absolutely beautiful. But as I'm on stage, I get to kind of watch the crowd. And as those doors fly open, what ends up happening inevitably is everybody's eyes turn towards her. And, you know, people start crying. Oh, my gosh, she's so beautiful. But then, like, it's funny. It's almost like a tennis match. They all then go to him, all the eyes, to see, you know, what he's thinking, what he's doing, if he's still there. You know, he's just taken everything in his life, everything that this life could throw at him. He's been confident, strong, and ready. And oftentimes, he's just kind of trying not to wet his pants with panic in that moment, because it's a game changer, and he totally knows it. But you know, there's been times where I go to weddings, and I'm just participating, I'm just in the crowd watching. Sometimes I don't even really know the couple very well, and as I watch the bride come down with just a huge smile, and at times he's standing there almost in tears, I have to admit, I often think, I wonder if they really know what they're getting into. And what I mean by that is, do they know what they've signed up for? Do they know what it actually means to be a godly husband, a godly wife? Has anybody ever sat down with them and talked to them about it? Do they know the call on their life? Or are they just getting married because culturally it's kind of like the next step that you're supposed to take when in love? So many of us experience these, our weddings, it's kind of like the intoxication of love, and then we come home from a honeymoon, it's either a couple days or a week or maybe a year, real life takes place. Real life happens. You know, the guy inevitably says something dumb, which I won't put you guys under the bus. I say something dumb. That's kind of my MO. then, you know, she at some point in time reads into something that isn't there and throws out the famous, if I have to tell you what's wrong, then that's the problem. Which, ladies, don't use that. It is, even the best guys, you're putting them in an absolute no-win situation. And at some point, the bliss is gone. What's happening? You know, I could talk about a lot of cultural worldviews that are very anti-biblical, go against Scripture, that we don't even know that we're starting to adopt, starting to believe in, and we're bringing into our marriage that are destroying us. But there's one I want to address today that as we look at biblical roles that God has given us in marriage, it has to be talked about, it has to be addressed, because it's pushing against specifically these principles that God has given us in the book of Ephesians. So let me say this. To be very clear, I'm married to an absolutely amazing woman on many levels, from intelligence to beauty to leadership capabilities to motherhood to spirituality to athletic ability. She's amazing. And I also have two daughters, which, by the way, I got to take to a father-daughter dance on Friday night. It was just amazing opening the doors for them and shutting the doors. And, I wanted to take them to a really, really nice dinner, even though they just wanted to go to McDonald's. But still, I wanted to treat them right. I'm telling you, I look at these two girls, and I'll be honest with you, I will fight to the death for their protection, their rights, their opportunities, their equality. But one of the ideologies in our culture that many of us are adopting, it isn't just equality, meaning, you know, we as men and women stand equal before God, therefore we should have equal rights and opportunities. Scripture is very clear about that. You know, sometimes people say the Bible's sexist. Man, it could not be further from the truth. Jesus and Paul were the first people, really, in history that were standing up for the equality of women and how awesome they really are. But as we move forward, our culture has moved from equal, meaning equal rights and opportunity, which I'm all for, to equal, meaning we're the same. That there's no differences between the genders except for biology. Therefore, there's no difference to roles given to men and women by God. I don't know if you know this, but let me just say it as clear as I can. People, we are not the same. God has wired us very differently, not just biologically, and it's on those differences that God has given us different roles to glorify God and represent Him well, specifically in family and in the church. They're different, not better, not more important, not more spiritual, not more intelligent, just different. It's kind of like God the Father and Jesus. They are one, and yet they have different roles, but they're just as important as one another. So again, let me be as clear as I can as we progress. I honestly think I've met more women than men that are smarter than me. I've probably met more women than men that are more organized than me. I've probably met more women than men. Did I say that wrong last time? I've probably met more women than men that are more spiritual than me. And the reason why I say this is I just want to make it very clear as we dive in. There's a huge difference between saying we're different, that God has given us different roles based on those differences. There's a huge difference between saying that and trying to argue that men are better than women, or vice versa, because that's not true. And it is kind of weird to me, it's crazy to me, that I actually, in 2016, have to make this argument. I have to take a little time to teach that we're different. I mean, our kids know it. You know, this is typically, not always, but typically, you know, your family going down the street and the kids are running, they fall down to the ground and they scrape their knee. 9 times out of 10, who do they run to? They run to mama. They know she's going to hug them and kiss them and love them and get them some ice and give them a Band-Aid even when there's no blood. Listen, by the way, rule, no blood, no Band-Aid. But they go to mama because they get that compassion that they're looking for. But, you know, 9 times out of 10, not always. If they're scared or they have a nightmare, who do they come to? They come to dad. I'm bigger, I'm stronger, I have a different demeanor. They know I'll run through a brick wall for their protection. We're different and they know it. But many of us take these skewed views, we're the same in the marriage, not knowing how to then live out our roles given to us as men and women. Then you add the sinful nature to it, and you've just got disaster waiting to happen. And by the way, where did this start? It actually begins all the way back in Genesis chapter 2, in the very beginning. God picks the biggest moron on earth, Adam, which, by the way, he was the only moron on earth. And by the way, us guys probably don't, you know, fall too far from that tree. But He comes to Adam and he communicates to Adam the word of God. And if you remember, it's in Genesis 2 where he says, Adam, listen to me. The garden is yours. Eat from anything that you would like, except for one tree, that one right there. You cannot eat from it. If you do, you will die. The actual Hebrew there is die. It's like death. It's like game over. Everything will change. Now, in reading this, I don't know if you've ever noticed, but she's not there. She's not around. She's not even created yet. It's his job from the very beginning to lead the family spiritually. So if you remember the story, Satan then shows up in chapter 3, and who does he go after? He goes after Eve. Why? Is she weaker? Nope. Less intelligent? Nope. Less spiritual? Nope. He's actually banking on the idea that Adam won't do his job as a spiritual leader. And so he goes after her. She gets the gist of the truth, but she chooses rationale over obedience, and then she eats. If you read the passage, you might have missed this, but read it again. It actually says, right after she's having this conversation, she eats, and it says, he was with her. Wait, time out. You're telling me Adam is standing there watching this conversation between Satan and her, leading her in temptation, and he's just standing there completely indifferent. He doesn't say a thing. He doesn't step up. And then maybe the most discouraging words of all of Scripture, it then says, he took and ate. Wait, time out, what? Adam, you were given one instruction. One. And you could not get that right. And the result of that day has plagued marriages from the very beginning, ever since. There's confusion. And because of our skewed understanding of roles, it grows into some kind of weird gladiator match over time. You know, who's in control here? Who's going to hold out the longest, be the strongest, yell the loudest, so she will yell at him, and he's frustrated, so maybe he becomes domineering and makes her account for every minute and every dollar spent. She doesn't like that, so she goes and gets a secret credit card and goes on some kind of retail therapy. She then starts whispering to the kids, and so does she, and you can see where it goes. Now, the rhetorical question, meaning we know the answer to it, is this what God intended? No, obviously not, because God loves us, and he created marriage as a gift to us. He doesn't want us just to survive it. He wants us to thrive within it, and so he has given us some principles that will allow us to do so in Ephesians chapter 5. Now, if you're single in the room, listen, don't check out on me. I want you to participate. This message might be actually more important for you, because what I want you to do, especially if you're in this dating context, if you're in love and you're thinking about marriage, I want you to count the cost. I want you to ask the question as we lay this out, am I ready to take on this responsibility that God has given me, that God asks of me if I get married? For those of you who are married in the room, what I would ask you to do, if you're doing it great or not, is just do the best you can to lay down your pride this morning, just say, God, teach me. Where might I be falling short here? Because one of the dangers of a message like this, because I've seen it happen before, is you're listening to the message and all you're thinking about is how far short your spouse is coming. Control what you can control. Now, real quick disclaimer before we dive in. I gave a big one last week. Let me give you a tiny one today. This is the ideal, meaning this is what God's perfection is for us. So I say that out loud because all of us are going to fall short of this here and there. You know, I'm preparing this message this last week knowing at some point in time my wife is going to be listening to these principles, and I all of a sudden feel incredibly inadequate because I see the areas that I fall short, but she, I hope like you, she knows my heart and she knows I want to get better, and so we try to together. So let's dive in. Ephesians 5:22 starts off speaking to the women in the room. He says, wives, submit to your husbands as to the Lord. Dun, dun, dun. You know, every time I preach this message, I could just feel the tension in the room. I feel like I could just cut it with a knife. Inevitably, I have a few women just sitting there with their arms crossed looking at me. Hey, man, if you think I'm going to submit to that joker, you got another thing coming. But we got a problem, and that is Satan is real. He's alive, and he wants to destroy us. And he knows if he can destroy, he knows to destroy a community, which will inevitably destroy a city, which inevitably destroys a nation. He wants to destroy the nations, and he knows the way to do that is to destroy the family. It is the core of every nation. Good families, great nation. Bad, falling apart families, difficult nation. And that's what we're seeing today. And so he attacks the family by doing this. He's taken this word, submit, and he's turned it into a bad word. And because of this, there's a misperception of what it really means. Many think this word means weakness or demeaning or lower or less than, that you're to be a doormat, should have no opinion or no say. To be submissive means throw an apron on, cook some cookies, clean the toilets, and serve your man as if you were a maid. That's not what it means. Let me be as clear as possible. I want to speak against Satan. It's not what it means. In fact, if you're in your Bibles, look at chapter 6, verse 1. Ephesians 6, 1. Then also 6, 5. It says, children, what's the word? Obey your parents. Later in 6, 5, it says, servants, obey your masters. That is a different Greek word there with a very different meaning. Listen, it's an important distinction. The call of God on wives is not to obey your husband as a servant obeys a master. You both actually stand equal in leadership before God as human beings, regardless of gender, before marriage. Now, let me just take a sidestep. I'm going to have a few of these today. I've seen this happen a couple of times. If you're dating someone, I've seen a for whatever reason, a domineering kind of power, quote-unquote, spiritual, but not really guy, dating a girl, and I've had them come into my office, this has happened multiple times, where he literally is saying, I need you to tell her in these particular areas of my life to do what I'm asking her to do because the Bible says she's to submit to me. I'm like, time out. You're not married. You don't have that leadership in her life right now. If anybody does, her dad does. Right now, you actually stand before God equals in leadership. But you need to know, if you choose to get married, when you become a family, when you become one, there must be a head, and therefore, what this word means, women in the room, as an ultimate display of godliness, as the ultimate display of being a follower of Jesus Christ, he asks us, as women, when you get married, he says, to come up under, that's the word, that's what it means, somebody else's God-ordained leadership. Now, it's a big key here. This is why I've said from the very beginning, ladies, all you single ladies in the room, make sure that you are doing the best you can to marry a man who will submit to the lordship of Jesus Christ. Because in the passage, there's no distinction between being a godly man, a Christian man, or just a man. It says submit to your husbands, which means you're called to submit regardless if he's a Christian or not. Now, listen, sidestep again. If he's asking you to do something ungodly or sinful, of course not. But this is why we need to find someone that's a Christian, godly man, submitted to the lordship of Jesus Christ. And by the way, you can't wait till he deserves it. Why? Because he never will. Never. No one in this room deserves it. In fact, the passage very clear is, submit to your husbands, what? As to the Lord. You're not doing it for him. You're doing it in obedience to Christ. The word actually was a military term. So ladies in the room, get this picture. Let's say you're walking down the street, and this guy, a colonel or major in the army, he's all dressed up, and he walks up to you and says, what are you doing? Get down and give me 20. What are you going to say? No, I'm not in the army. I'm not underneath your leadership. I'm not underneath your authority. But you have a choice. If you willingly join, then you are willingly putting yourself under somebody's God-ordained leadership. And it isn't about, you know, telling someone what to do or obeying, it's willingly acting in such a valiant way, that's how a soldier would look at it, that you're submitting to another's authority in honor so that you both can go in the same direction and win as a team. It's a core of Christianity. There's absolute beautiful for both men and women because all of us have to submit at some place in life. There's beautiful self-worth and godly submission. Now, next week, that's very theological and doctrinal. Next week, we're going to break it down a little more practically. What's that look like? With that said, though, this tiny little verse is given to the women. The rest of the entire passage is given to us men in the room, and it's big. Huge responsibility. Again, for you single men in the room, please take note. Don't take it lightly, because there are eternal implications. Therefore, handled incorrectly can have horrible consequences, not only in your life and in your marriage and your wife's life, but even affects your kids. I honestly believe if Paul gave no directives to women, and if Christian men in this room could just live out these verses, there would be little divorce within the church, and by and large, there would be fulfilled, satisfied, happy, thriving people living within marriage. So he says to us, men, in turn, we are to honor our wives. How? We're to honor them by loving them as Christ loved the church. He tells us four types of love we are to give our wives. Number one, sacrificial love. Verse 25 says this, husbands, love your wives just as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her. I want that verse to just marinate for a second. You are to love your wife as Christ loved the church. For those women in the room that have had maybe a little struggle with what I've said up to this point, I'm sure there's a few, I would just ask you to go before the Lord humbly and just, let me ask you this question. In humility, could you possibly submit, willingly place yourself under the leadership of a man who will love you as Jesus Christ loved the church? How did Jesus love the church? Well, we could be here for days, right? But simply, he first humbled himself and became a man, which means he put everybody else ahead of himself. He then went and died on a cross for people's sin. He then rose again on the third day. He then gave us the best gift of all time by giving us the Holy Spirit and then spiritual gifts so that we could live out the call of God in our life. You know, it's funny, I get to this point and it might seem very hard, but it's kind of humorous to me because I think initially it excites guys in the room. Kind of brings out the brave heart in you, the gladiator. That's right. I'll die for my woman. You'll die for her once. But that's not what the verse means in totality. To die for our wives once is possible, but it's almost nigh to impossible without the grace of God and the power of the Holy Spirit working in your life to die daily to your own desires and wants and defer to hers. How did Christ love the church? He died for the church, for sure, but it was so much more. He served the church. He provides for the church. He teaches the church. He nurtures the church. He protects the church. He stewards the church. He manages the church. He leads the church. It's not just to die once, it's to die daily. He gave himself up for her. Guys, listen. For your wives in the room to be able to submit with any kind of joy, it's pretty much up to us. And again, single guys in the room, if you get up in the morning, you look into the mirror, and you're impressed, you're not ready to get married. We need to constantly think, where are my priorities? Is God number one? Because what God tells you to do, he says, if I'm number one, you're submitting to me, the number one person in your life is your wife ahead of you. That's what he calls for. So you got to think, is that car most important? Is that 7-iron most important? Is that job most important? Because if it is, you've got a problem. To be right with God, we must lay ourselves down. You know, I get in conversations with guys a lot, and I'll be hanging out talking. Hey, how's your relationship with Jesus? How's your relationship with God? Oh, it's awesome. It's going really well. These are all the great things that are happening. And then I'll ask a question, something like, well, how's your relationship with your wife? Well, I don't know. They're not going great. You don't know her. She's a shrew. It's really difficult. But man, I love Jesus. I have to kind of say, it doesn't really work that way. Your relationship with God is partly based on how you are doing with your wife, at least what you can control. And to be honest with you, there are some men in the room that you probably just need to go to your wife and say, I'm sorry. Will you forgive me? I've kind of made this whole thing about me. Kind of thinking about me more than you. Will you please forgive me? Now, you can't control how she's going to respond to that. But I will tell you this, women predominantly, words are nice, but they like action so much more. And so they're probably going to sit back and wait a little while to see if it's real. So the second kind of love, sacrificial, is number one. Second, we're going to give her a purifying love. Verse 26 and 27 says, to make her holy, cleansing her by washing with water through the word, to present her to himself, a radiant church. It goes on to say, without blemish, holy, and blameless. And I can lose people along the way here. But what this is saying for us and the men in the room, you are to give your wife a protecting love, meaning you're protecting your marriage from things that can creep in, destroy. And it starts with you. It really does. And we're going to talk a little bit more about this next week, kind of unpack it practically. But it starts with you. You know, how are you treating her? How are you treating other women? Are you flirting with other women? How do you talk? What language do you use? How do you talk about other women? What do you look at? How's your personal purity? Protect your marriage. Thirdly, give her a caring love. In the same way, husbands, verse 28, ought to love their wives as their own bodies. He who loves his wife loves himself. After all, no one ever hated his own body, but he feeds and cares for, just as Christ does the church, for we are members of one body. I love the way this verse says it. It's basically saying we have no problem meeting our own needs and desires, but men in the room, you are called to meet hers first. And so, let's say that you have this great night planned with the guys, you're really excited about it, and you come home, and she's obviously had a train wreck of a day. You don't ignore that. You step into it. Maybe even sacrificially give up the night to meet her needs, to listen, to do the best you can to feel what she's feeling. Now listen, women, we're not good at this. So give us a bone if we're trying, all right? If we're trying to understand, give us at least a star, okay? A little gold star somewhere on the refrigerator, because we're trying. And guys, try not to give you the quick fix. She probably actually could fix it herself. She wants you to feel what she's feeling. We're going to talk a little bit more about that next week. Then lastly, an unbreakable love. We are to give her an unbreakable love. Verse 31 says, for this reason, a man will leave his father and mother and be united to his wife, and the two will become one flesh. The way you act around her, treat her, talk to her, that she knows, she just knows, no matter how hard things get, no matter what happens, you're not going anywhere. You know, one of the great secrets to a great marriage is understanding that love is not a feeling. You know, we get these feelings where they're so nice, and so when they're there, we love them, but when they go away, we think we're not in love anymore. Love is not a feeling. It's a decision. It's an action. It's something that we do regardless of how we feel. And even the greatest marriages in this room, they will tell you there is a day, there comes a time where you just don't really feel like loving the other person, but you love them anyways, and that's the secret. You find a love on the backside of some of those difficulties by acting out love that's even deeper than what you experience on your wedding day. Unbreakable love. I'm not going anywhere. Let me end with this. You know, anytime we discuss something like this, I just know that there's some marriages in the room that are struggling. Anywhere from minor irritations to it's DEFCON 5. I know that. It's just, anytime we discuss it, and marriages can be like a field sometimes. You look at it and it's got some grass and it's got some flowers and it's really nice. But once you get in there and start working and toiling, some things are sometimes under the soil that are really ugly and nasty and difficult, and they come out in a message like this. It can be hard to hear and it can be painful. Here's what I want to say to you. Do something about it. Do something. If it's minor irritations all the way to do something. Take an action. If you don't know what to do, call the church and say, hey, we heard the message and we need to talk to a pastor. They might not talk to you right then or call you back that day, but they'll get a hold of you, set up a meeting where you can come in and just have an assessment where we're at and what are some things that you might be able to do to work towards it. Because here's what happens. If you ignore it, from minor irritations to really difficult situations, it's not going to go away. And what ends up happening is it gets worse and worse and worse, and the longer you wait, the harder it is to deal with. It's kind of like your backyard. If you go into your backyard and you mow the lawn weekly and, you know, trim the trees or, you know, pull the weeds, you know, sometimes you enjoy it, sometimes you don't. It's work. It's maintenance. You got to do it, though. But if you don't do it for, like, 2 years and you walk into your backyard, you walk in, it's, like, out of control. And here's the danger. You look at it and decide just to get another house, instead of actually dealing with it. Do something now. Take an action step now. Now, today's message was very doctrinal. It's very theological. We're actually going to look at the same passage next week, but I want to be real practical. I want to talk about, okay, that's nice, but how do we actually do that in 2016? What are some things that we both can be doing and understand about one another that allows us to live out these roles that God has given us? Let's pray. God, thank you so much for who you are and what you're doing in and amongst us. First and foremost, God, I just pray for the marriages in the room that are hurting right now. There's people I know, I don't even know who they are, but there's people sitting next to each other, and this is uncomfortable. They're really hurting, and they both know it. I would just ask that you would just miraculously breathe a breath of fresh air, a hope, that you are a God of miracles and redemption. I would pray for the person in this room that's by themselves, but they're married, and they showed up today, and it's just a disaster, and they're really hurting. I just pray that you do something special with them, and I also pray for all those who are single in the room, whatever that might look like, that they would really take seriously the call that you have on our life if we choose to move into marriage, and with your help, do the best we can to live it out. I pray this in Jesus' name, and God's people said, hey, God bless you. I want to remind you, we always have prayer warriors that would love to pray with you for whatever reason. Hope to see you next Sunday.